Hi history lovers, welcome or welcome back to the channel where I bring you new videos every Friday with an emphasis on royal history and historical mysteries. Today on History Calling, we are looking at the life of Queen Mary I, specifically her reign. Mary was the first Queen of England who managed to hang on to the job, but she almost didn't get to the throne thanks to a conspiracy to replace her with her cousin Lady Jane Grey. Stay tuned to hear how Mary defeated her opponent and what she did to earn the nickname Bloody Mary. We'll also look at her unpopular marriage, her difficult relationship with her half-sister Elizabeth, and the rare phantom pregnancies she suffered. If you'd like to learn more about Mary's earlier life, see my previous two videos on her, which look at how her happy childhood became a nightmarish adolescence and adulthood, thanks to the cruelty of her father and brother, Henry VIII and Edward VI. You can also learn more about the Tudors by watching the other videos in my Tudor Monarchs playlist and the series I have on the six wives of Henry VIII. I'll leave links to these in the description box, as well as to resources discussing or depicting Mary's life, including the TV show The Tudors and the movie Elizabeth. Please remember to like, share and comment on this video and subscribe to the channel with notifications switched on so you never miss a new video. You can also find me over on Instagram where my username is HistoryCalling. At the end of the last video, it was the 6th of July 1553 and Mary's brother, the Protestant King Edward, had just died, but not without taking one last parting shot at his Catholic sister. Desperate to stop her from inheriting the throne, he had attempted to undo the last will and testament of their father, which left the crown to Mary next, by writing a document known as his device for the succession. This bypassed both Mary and Elizabeth and directed the throne to the 15-year-old Lady Jane Grey, the daughter of their cousin Francis Brandon Grey, an action which was much to Jane's surprise, it must be said. In so doing, Edward had left both his sisters in mortal danger. They were the legal heirs to the throne, and it's hard to believe that if Jane's supporters had succeeded in grabbing the crown, they would have let these two sisters live. Mary knew the danger she was in. Lady Jane was married to Guildford Dudley, son of the Duke of Northumberland, and when Mary learned, just before Edward's death, that Northumberland was planning to make his daughter-in-law queen, she fled from her home in Hertfordshire with a small retinue of servants and travelled north, with Northumberland and his men hot on her tail. After a night in Sawston Hall in Cambridgeshire, she moved to Hengrave Hall near Bury St Edmunds, then Euston Hall, then to her home in Kenning Hall in Norfolk. By then she knew of Edward's death and just how precarious her situation was. Jane's supporters held London and even the Spanish ambassadors when writing to her cousin Emperor Charles V on the 7th of July felt that it now seems that the Lady Mary's person will be in danger and her promotion to the crown so difficult as to be well nigh impossible in the absence of a force large enough to counterbalance that of her enemies. Despite being her cousin, Charles didn't lift a finger to help her, and his correspondents in England clearly doubted her ability to gather such a force on her own. But they, like Jane's family, underestimated her. Mary declared herself queen and wrote to Jane's council demanding that they do the same. They refused, and instead Northumberland took an army out of London on the 13th of July to attempt to capture her. Mary was highly popular in England, however, something which often gets forgotten when people discuss her later career as Bloody Mary, and soon local gentry were rallying to her cause, bringing with them men, money and weapons. On the 12th of July, with her supporters increasing in number and her popularity with the common people so evident that even those who had initially declared for Jane were now coming to her side, Mary moved to Framlingham Castle in Suffolk and prepared to make her stand. Back in London, many of Jane's supporters lost their nerve and deserted her, declaring instead for Mary and having her proclaimed queen on the streets of the capital on the 20th of July. When Northumberland heard the news, he was forced to admit defeat. No battle ever occurred, and the errant Duke was instead arrested at Cambridge. Mary had her throne, and Jane was kept locked in the Tower. The new queen now travelled to London, meeting up with her sister Elizabeth along the way. She arrived to scenes of great joy amongst the citizens on the 3rd of August. 19 days later, the Duke of Northumberland was executed on Tower Hill, though none of the other conspirators were killed. Yet. Jean begged forgiveness, explaining that she had known nothing of the plot until it was too late and had not given her consent to it. Mary believed her, and though she was urged by the Emperor to have her young cousin executed, she refused, saying that Jean was blameless in the whole affair and that her conscience, quote, would not permit her to have her put to death. Jean and her husband Guildford were instead kept in separate rooms in the Tower of London, where you can still see these pieces of graffiti recording her name and most likely carved by one of her supporters, perhaps even her husband. The level of forgiveness and mercy Mary showed to virtually all the conspirators was remarked upon with amazement. Even Jane's father, the Duke of Suffolk, who was up to his neck in the plan, was quickly released on the 31st of July. Others, having apologised and sworn allegiance to the new Queen, gained positions in the new regime, though this was at least partly because Mary needed their support in order to rule effectively. She was also surprisingly lenient at this stage in matters of religion. She had allowed Edward to be buried in a Protestant ceremony on the 9th of August and didn't initially pressure her subjects to adopt Catholicism, saying that no changes to state religion would be made until Parliament had met. A notable exception to this policy, however, was her sister, whose position as heiress to the throne made her submission more important than that of any other. Elizabeth did make some moves towards embracing Catholicism, including attending Mass on occasion, but her reluctance was evident at times, and Mary doubted her sincerity. The coronation occurred on the 1st of October at Westminster Abbey, and Mary's initial parliament then opened 4 days later. One of the first things it did was to declare that the marriage of Henry VIII and Catherine of Aragon was valid and Mary legitimate. It must have been a moment of triumph for the woman who had endured so much abuse at the hands of her father for her refusal to admit her parents had not been lawfully married, to finally be able to overthrow his actions and vindicate herself and her mother. At the same time, Thomas Cranmer, the Protestant Archbishop of Canterbury, was now imprisoned in the Tower. Ostensibly, this was because of his involvement in the plot to put Jane Grey on the throne, but Mary surely hadn't forgotten that he was also the man who had annulled her parents' marriage back in 1533 and married Henry VIII to Anne Boleyn. This Parliament also began the rollback of the English Reformation. Just as Edward had suspected, Mary reversed his religious legislation, including the requirement to use the 1549 Book of Common Prayer, and returned to the religious settlement of Henry VIII's later reign. She also ensured that it was no longer a crime to deny the royal supremacy, though for reasons of politics, no one who'd gained money and land in the Reformation wanted to give it back, she stopped short of formally reinstating papal supremacy in England. Instead, she remained the supreme head of the church there, at least for the time being. The following year, she took matters further. Masses were restored to churches and were to be spoken in Latin. Protestant practices were abandoned. Priests who had married had to leave their wives. Speaking of marriage, Mary now turned to selecting her own husband. She relied on the advice of her cousin and former fiancé, Charles V, in this matter, and unsurprisingly, he promoted his son, Prince Philip of Spain, a man 11 years Mary's junior and who referred to her as his aunt. It was an unpopular choice in England, where the favoured candidate had been Edward Courtney, Earl of Devon, a great-grandson of Edward IV. The French hated it too, given their continuing animosity to Spain. After Mary accepted the proposal in late October 1553, a parliamentary delegation tried to dissuade her from her choice the following month, but she refused to be budged. She had seriously underestimated English fears of a foreign ruler, however, and combined with the religious changes she was initiating, her choice soon led to open revolt. The objective of the revolt, which was scheduled to occur in March 1554, was to depose Mary in favour of Elizabeth, who would be married off to Courtney, and the plan had the support of the French. Details leaked in January, however, especially after Courtney confessed his involvement, and some conspirators fled England, while the remainder attempted an ill-prepared rising 2 months earlier than they had intended. Lady Jane Grey's father, the Duke of Suffolk, who had only just been pardoned for his involvement in the attempt to replace Mary with his daughter, gathered a small force in Leicestershire, but this was soon quashed, and he was arrested and placed in the Tower. Sir Thomas Wyatt the Younger did better. He brought together around 3,000 men in Kent. They even met at his home, Allington Castle, which you can see here. And when the Duke of Norfolk took a detachment of men to defeat them, many of those men defected and left, unwilling to fight their own countrymen in order to help a Spaniard marry their queen. Wyatt refused Mary's overtures of diplomacy, and London itself now came under threat of attack. Mary refused to leave her capital, however, and instead gave an impassioned speech at the Guildhall on the 1st of February, in which she declared herself married to England, swore her love for her people, and said that she would not wed Philip without the approval of Parliament and the nobility. It worked. With London behind her, Wyatt's attempt to enter the city on the 3rd of February failed, and after 3 days he left and travelled to Kingston to cross the Thames. On the 7th he entered the city and attacked and was intercepted at Temple Bar by Mary's soldiers. The Queen's men were victorious. Wyatt was captured that afternoon and taken to the Tower. Unlike the previous year, Mary now showed little mercy to the conspirators, or indeed to anyone connected to them. There were mass arrests and hangings of those involved in the plot, including the men who had abandoned the Duke of Norfolk when he went to confront Wyatt. The Duke of Suffolk was executed on the 23rd of February, but not before he had seen how his actions had brought about the destruction of his daughter, Lady Jane Grey, and her husband, Guildford Dudley. Despite having taken no part in the insurrection, it was deemed too dangerous to let this potential claimant to the throne live. And so, on the 12th of February, first Guildford, then the 17-year-old Jane, were executed at the Tower in an event which has become known as one of the great stains upon the Queen's reputation and reign. On the same day they died, Edward Courtney was placed in the Tower of London as a prisoner, and Elizabeth was brought from her home at Ashridge to Whitehall Palace, arriving near the end of the month. Mary wouldn't see her, and on the 16th of March, thanks to evidence that Elizabeth had been in touch with the rebels, though there was nothing to suggest that she had approved of their plans, she was charged with being a co-conspirator and placed in the Tower the following day. She confessed to nothing, however, nor would Wyatt implicate her, instead exonerating her at his execution on the 11th of April. Still, the Queen's sister remained in custody, first at the Tower, then from mid-May at Woodstock, under the care of Sir Henry Bedingfield. On the 25th of July, having obtained the blessing of Parliament, the Queen married Philip of Spain at Winchester Cathedral. Her husband was now styled King of England, though he had no regal powers there. Just a few months later, in September, Mary's monthly cycle stopped, she had nausea, and she began to gain weight. She announced that she was pregnant. While all of this was happening, the return of England to Catholicism was also continuing apace. On the 20th of November 1554, Reginald Pole, the Pope's legate and the son of Margaret Pole, Countess of Salisbury, who you may remember from last week's video was Mary's governess but who had been executed by Henry VIII, finally returned to England after a 20-year exile. He was a strong proponent of restoring the country to papal authority as fast as possible and had been practically berating Mary to do so since she came to the throne. He was about to get his wish. On the 30th of November, on behalf of Pope Julius III, he formally received England back into the Catholic Church, forgiving its people for their sin in straying. With her parents' marriage declared valid, her country restored to Catholicism, a marriage to Spain completed, and a baby on the way, Mary now seemed to be on the brink of getting everything she had wanted since her childhood. But things didn't proceed as planned. For most of the apparent pregnancy, things had seemed normal enough. By November, the Imperial Ambassador, Simon Reynard, was reporting that Mary's clothes did not fit her belly and that she had felt the baby kicking. The birth was expected at the beginning of May 1555 and the royal nursery was readied. On the 23rd of April, Mary began her confinement, meaning the period of time before and for a month after the birth, during which she would be attended by women only, at Hampton Court Palace. Elizabeth was released from her house arrest and brought to court at around the same time to witness the arrival of the child who would displace her from the throne forever, or so it was hoped. But then, nothing. There were rumours of a miscarriage, a faked pregnancy, or even that Mary was dead, but in her chambers her women suspected that she had never been pregnant at all. As one of them said, the Queen was able to sit for hours with her knees drawn up to her chin, something no woman in the later stages of pregnancy would have been able to do without great pain. At the start of August, Mary quietly left Hampton Court. There was no more talk of an impending birth. So what had happened? Historians' best guess is that Mary suffered a phantom pregnancy, now known as pseudocyesis, and possibly brought on by her desperation to conceive. This caused all the normal symptoms of pregnancy, and in an era without tests or ultrasounds, there was no way to know that she was mistaken. This was yet another tragic blow for a woman who had already suffered so much in her life, and Mary must surely have been distraught and humiliated. Her husband was disappointed too, and having now stayed in England for far longer than he had ever intended, he departed back to the continent in early September, leaving Mary ever more disconsolate. 1555 would prove to be a disastrous year for many others in England too, for at the same time the Queen had been happily awaiting the birth of her child, the religious restoration took on the much more ominous tone for which it is remembered, and we see the start of the behaviour which led to her earning the nickname Bloody Mary, for she had embarked on a policy of burning so-called heretics. For most of us today, it's impossible to understand how someone who professed to be a good Christian, or even just a good person, all religion aside, could justify to themselves the use of such barbaric methods. So I think it's worth pausing for a moment here to try to get into Mary's mindset at this point in her life. The most simplistic explanation would be that she hated Protestantism because her father had broken with the Catholic Church to marry Anne Boleyn, and this had ultimately led to much of the misery in Mary's own life, including her religious persecution at the hands of her brother Edward. As we'll see in a minute, there was indeed an element of revenge at work, but only in very limited cases, and overall, Mary's motives were more complex. She believed that heresy was a danger not just to the souls of the so-called heretics, but to any simple people, to use her phrase, who came into contact with them and who might be led astray from the true Catholic faith by their preachings, then become heretics themselves and ultimately lose their place in heaven. In short, she viewed it as a disease, and the only cure for the non-repentant to stop them spreading that disease was to kill them. In so doing, she argued that she was saving the souls of the rest of her subjects as a good queen ought to. The idea that people should have the right to determine their own faith didn't cross her mind. She believed that she knew best and that she had the right to impose her will on everyone else, even to the point of killing them. Many of those burnt were religious men who had preached Protestantism and refused to recant despite promises of leniency if they did. Others were simply common people. Men and women who were sometimes denounced by their neighbours as part of private quarrels. It was the most horrific method of execution, incredibly painful and protracted, and I can't even go into details of what happened here because I think it would stress you too much and YouTube might not allow it. Mary had believed that it wouldn't take many burnings to stamp out Protestantism, but here we see just how out of touch she was with the reality of the religious changes in her country and how far her religious extremism would take her. Unlike in her youth, Protestantism was no longer just the preserve of a small group, but a widespread movement, and many didn't want England to return to papal authority or be under the yoke of the Catholic Spanish now that Mary had married Philip. Nearly 300 people would be burnt between 1554 and 1558, and their bravery and strength of faith in the face of their terrible deaths made a deep impression on those who saw them killed or heard of their demise. Far from stamping out the new religion, Mary gave it hundreds of martyrs and hardened attitudes towards herself, her faith, and her reign. Some of her advisers who could see the damage her actions were causing to her own and to Philip's reputations, because the king was blamed by some for what was happening, urged her to stop, but she didn't. For her, this would have been giving a green light to heresy. Much more so than her treatment of Lady Jane Grey or her marriage, this wholesale slaughter of otherwise unoffending subjects who posed no threat to her person or her rule ruined her reputation, then and now. There is some debate as to how much of the impetus for this policy came from Mary herself and how much blame can be laid at the door of Reginald Pole, but the fact remains that the burnings couldn't have occurred without her consent and that she could have ordered them stopped at any time. One of the most famous executions, and one definitely motivated by a desire for personal revenge on Mary's part, was that of former Archbishop of Canterbury, Thomas Cranmer. Having been in prison since early in her reign, he had actually provided written recantations of his Protestantism multiple times in February 1556, which ought to have been enough to save his life. Mary, however, wanted him dead, and having been degraded from all his church offices, he was burnt for heresy on the 21st of March. It should have been an out-and-out win for the Queen, but Cranmer managed to take control of the narrative at the last minute. At what ought to have been his last confession in a church just before his death, he retracted his former recantations, saying that I renounce and refuse, as things written with my hand, contrary to the truth which I thought in my heart, and written for fear of death, and to save my life, if it might be, and that is, all such bills which I have written or signed with mine own hand since my degradation, wherein I have written many things untrue. And forasmuch as my hand offended in writing contrary to my heart, therefore my hand shall first be punished, for if I may come to the fire, it shall be first burned. He meant every word. As this stained glass window shows, after he had then been dragged to the stake and tied to it, he held out the hand which had signed his recantations so that it would be burnt first, shouting, "Unworthy right hand," as the flames took it. It was a Protestant PR coup. At the same time, other domestic matters continued to plague the Queen. There was a further conspiracy to oust her in early 1556, this time led by Sir Henry Dudley, a cousin of Lady Jane Grey's father and also a relation of her father-in-law, thus the shared surname. Once again, the plan was to replace Mary with Elizabeth, and once again, the plot was foiled and many of its leaders executed, though Dudley stayed safe in France. The Queen suspected her sister of involvement and arrested some of her servants, but on Philip's orders she didn't arrest Elizabeth herself, for the King feared his sister-in-law being executed and the English throne passing to Mary Queen of Scots, who was destined to marry the King of France, when Mary Tudor died. Instead, the Queen temporarily kept Elizabeth under a form of honourable house arrest and guard until the end of the year. The matter of her sister's treatment also strained her already difficult marriage, for Philip had still not returned to England, and Mary had heard stories of his philandering on the continent. He pushed to have Elizabeth married off to his cousin, something she refused to do, and said that he would blame Mary if this didn't occur. Foreign policy was going no better. Philip finally returned to England in March 1557 to obtain English assistance in Spain's conflict with France. Despite initial resistance from Mary's council, he got what he wanted. England declared war on France on the 7th of June, and, his mission accomplished, Philip left England a month later, never to see Mary again. An English army soon followed him to the continent, but despite some initial successes, the war was ultimately a failure for them. The greatest blow came when the town of Calais, England's last foothold in France, which had been in its possession since 1347, was lost to the French in January 1558. To top it all off, the Pope, who was an ally of the French King Henri II, punished England and Mary for involvement in the war by stripping Reginald Pole, Archbishop of Canterbury, of his status of papal legate and accusing him of heresy. This greatly offended and wounded the Queen. She was a fervent Catholic who had done everything she could to return England to papal obedience, burning hundreds of her subjects along the way with Pole's assistance. Yet now, both were betrayed by the Pope himself. At the time, Mary thought she was pregnant once more and told Philip as much in January 1558. But just as in 1555, she was mistaken. More likely, it was another pseudo-pregnancy or a symptom of illness. Her health then deteriorated further over the course of the summer and autumn. By the 6th of November, she knew the end was near and formally acknowledged Elizabeth as her successor, something she had always been desperate to avoid. Death came 11 days later in the early hours of the 17th. She was 42, and despite the popularity she had enjoyed throughout her life and even just 5 years earlier at her accession, her death was not widely mourned. Instead, for the next 300 years, the date of her demise was marked with celebrations in England as the day Elizabeth came to the throne. So how should we sum up the life of Mary I? Well, I have to say that in putting together this video and the previous two I've done on her, I actually came to feel a great deal of pity and even admiration for her. The bright, pretty, and above all happy princess who had danced for foreign envoys in her youth was broken down over the ensuing decades by numerous disappointments and mistreatment at the hands of a cruel father and stepmother, intolerant brother, neglectful husband, rebellious subjects, and even a scheming sister. Despite her obvious devotion to the Catholic faith, for which she'd suffered so much abuse in her life, even the Pope abandoned her in the end. She was plagued from her teens onwards by increasingly poor health, including bouts of depression brought on by her many disappointments, and every time it seemed like things were looking up for her, something else would come along to pull the rug out from under her feet and ruin any happiness she'd been able to accrue. If any of us suffered like that, who's to say what kind of person we would be or what we would do? Yet despite her flaws, no one can deny that Mary had many admirable qualities too. She was steadfast in her beliefs and showed exceptional and long-lasting strength and bravery in her dealings with Henry VIII and Edward VI. She was a fighter who, despite all the odds, won her throne from those who would have stolen it from her, and her refusal to leave London for her own safety during Wyatt's rebellion shows the same Tudor steel that many often associate with Elizabeth at the time of the Spanish Armada. Does all this excuse the terrible things she oversaw during her reign? No, of course not, not even close. And no matter how much sympathy I have for her, it's always outweighed by the sympathy I have for the likes of Jane Grey and all the innocent people Mary had burned. Understanding her past does offer a better insight into her mind, however, and helps us to see that Mary was, above all, a complex and damaged individual rather than a two-dimensional villain. Personally, I think her life and her posthumous reputation could have turned out so much better if only she'd been better treated herself, and I see her as one of the Tudors' greatest tragedies and a well of wasted potential. What's your opinion, however? Do you think that she's been judged unfairly by history, that she did no worse than many others, but that her legacy has been tainted by sexism and the anti-Catholicism which became so virulent during her sister's reign? Or do you feel that no matter what, her sins overshadow her suffering and she deserves the poor reputation history has given her? Let me know in the comments below and do come back next week when we'll start delving into the life of the most famous Tudor of them all, Elizabeth I. Until then, keep learning.